Sangha Jodan Sogi Shonam La Janja Bardo Dani Kebsu Chi Dagi Jin Soji Basonangi Drola Pencher Sangha Drupar Shaw. Let's invoke the presence of spiritual masters, past, present, and future, from as many universes as there are grains of sand on the river Ganges. And if each grain of sand itself had a whole universe with thousands of river Ganges, to invoke the presence of all of those enlightenment masters, past, present, and future. Secondly, let's invoke the commitment to wisdom, to truth and wisdom, as the most important driving force in our life. How men and women think determine how men and women behave, what they do with their life. By having a commitment to truth and wisdom, we move toward enlightenment, and everyone we touch in our life is moved to some degree in the direction of goodness and wisdom. And thirdly, let's invoke the inspiration of all the great practitioners of all traditions. Secondly, let's make four wishes. Do you have pennies with you? I brought a bucket. If you don't, just throw in a gold coin. First, the wish that all beings have happiness and the causes of happiness. Not only may they be happy, but however they are happy, maybe it's such a way that it goes from happiness to greater happiness, not personal happiness to greater catastrophe. Secondly, may all beings be free from suffering, discontent, stress, anxiety, and the causes of those conditions. Thirdly, may all beings rest in a happy mind that has no limit or downfall. And fourthly, let's all of us try to develop the wisdom of equanimity, which has affection for and respect for all living beings, regardless of whether they're obviously pleasant or not so obviously pleasant, perhaps seemingly very unpleasant. So as the expression goes in the Tibetan world, to those beings who we cherish and those beings with whom we feel great distance, may we have equal care, caringness, and respect for all of them. So all traditions of Central Asian Buddhism, including Bunpo, they always begin every spiritual gathering with those thoughts. Nagarjuna said, on every atom, there's 100 Buddhas, 100 enlightenment masters dancing and singing, just trying to come out and say hello to us. There's no lack of enlightenment masters and enlightenment energies. What there is a lack of us being open to the whispers of those invisible and great beings. I wanted to start by just talking a little bit about the context, and then we'll turn down the lights and we can use the slides. But in the Buddhist world, the idea of death is not something unpleasant or something sad or something morbid, but rather it's the key to transformation. In general, it's said there's three kinds of death and dying. Each moment we die, and each moment we're reborn. And for that reason, the one who can connect to that gap between two thought moments can achieve enlightenment on the spot. At the very least, they can leave behind all of those things that make them sad and unhappy, can drop those and can pick up things that make them glad and happy. And if we learn to live in mindfulness and to stay in the present moment, we learn the key to that bardo, that between two thought moments, the blank emptiness between two thought moments. Secondly, every day is a lifetime. Every night is a mini death. And the next morning is a new life. When we learn to live our day as a complete life, and we learn to wake up with a fresh set of eyes and ears, and a fresh way of listening and thinking and experience and breathing, each day is a key to our transformation. It's a key to our transcendence. Each morning waking up, we can leave behind the things from yesterday that didn't make us feel good, didn't make us feel strong, didn't make us feel big, didn't make us feel important. We can essentially leave behind those things by which we feel small, unimportant, insignificant, and powerless. By means of these two, in this lifetime, we can achieve enlightenment. That's the message of the great masters of the past. I was recently in Bangladesh, where they follow a form of Burmese Buddhism, which isn't very well known outside of that little part of the world. And one of the temples I went to had 28 Buddhas in it. And I wrote many of my friends, what about these 28? And nobody was very clued in. But according to the Burmese, and therefore the Bangladesh, because they share a border and trade and so on, oh, there's a $5,000 fine for anyone who comes late. Thank you for coming late. We hope many more will come late. So these 28, they say, from the time Buddha Shakyamuni first thought, I want to be a universal hero, 28 beings beat him to enlightenment. Got to enlightenment before he did. He was a little slow. So all of those 28 universally say that meditating on impermanence, death, dying, is one of the strongest keys to the attainment of lasting happiness, deeper happiness, eternal happiness. When we understand that each moment everything old dies, each moment everything is born anew. Each day, the sense, the whole world that we knew is gone. Each day, the next day, comes back in you, becomes the key to our enlightenment and the key to our happiness, the key to our transformation. A word used in all schools of Tibetan Buddhism, from Ladakh and Bhutan and Sikkim and Nepal, up through Tibet and the Mongol territories and Eastern Russia, is lung dor. And lung means picking things up, and dor means putting them down. And when a baby is born, they have to learn that, don't they? What they can pick up and what they can't pick up. what, when they pick up, they should put down very quickly. The Irish have that expression, putting it down as quickly as you put down a hot potato. I heard that even like other people have borrowed that expression from us and aren't paying royalty fees when they use it. But the path to enlightenment is very much to do with Pangwa Tang Langwa, or Lang Dor. Pangwa Tang Langwa. Pangwa here meaning throwing away. And Langwa, cultivating or taking up. And every moment we can learn what it is we don't have to bother with, what's useless to us in our life, what's not only useless to us, but makes our life heavy, makes it lethargic, makes it unhappy, makes it stressful, makes it filled with anxiety. I was looking over the web the other day for sayings of the Buddha. Well, actually, I put sayings of the Buddha in books by Glenn H. Mullin. I'm not narcissistic. It was an educational experience. What is it? Know thyself. And I came across a passage by Buddha. What did you get from meditation? And he says, I didn't get anything. But what I did do was I dropped a lot. I dropped unhappiness. I dropped suffering. I dropped stress. I dropped misery. And he makes a whole list of things big and small, which were dropped. But in the course of our enlightenment, the key is like a little baby learning what can we pick up and run with and what we shouldn't pick up and run with. It'll harm us and it'll harm others, and we create damage by doing it rather than happiness by doing it. The first book on Tibetan Buddhism that I read was Evans Wentz's 1927 edition of the Bardo Tudol, published by Oxford University, translated by Lama Kazay Sandup, Dawa Sandup. And I think many people will know that because it's probably had 30 reprints since then and stays in print around the world and sort of became a classic reader. It, of course, because it was a pioneer work, it wasn't totally accurately translated, and also it went into King James English, which is always odd to sort of hear Tibetans talking in King James English. And since then, about, I think, maybe 10 different translations of it have been made. But of those 10, the one by yours truly on the right is certainly the best. I hope those other translators aren't listening right now. If you are, please be patient. More is to come. The key message of the Bardo Tudol is that essentially we have constant, unremitting opportunity for enlightenment. So when Jung wrote his foreword to that first edition, as he points out, the book is every bit as much an important guide to daily life as it is to the death, dying, and transformation process. In fact, the first book I did on the subject of death and dying is the one on the, I think it's on your left. And that was kind of an odd book. I was working on a bunch of projects in India, and in 1984 was on my way to Canada. And the day before I left, I had a dream. I was walking down a street, and I saw a sign blowing in the wind. And a couple of days later in London, I was going to visit the very venerable Chime Rinpoche, who was at the time working in the British Museum. And there was that very sign I had seen blowing in the wind. And so I walked in and said hello, and it was a bookstore and book publisher. And I said, I write books on enlightenment, and the Himalayan enlightenment. And they said, oh, that's great, come on in. We're starting a series of 40 books a year, and we want to do two or three on Tibet. And I said, well, I don't have anything to show you, because the one I have, the corner, was eaten off by a mouse. And she said, oh, no matter. Just leave us the manuscript, and we'll do a photocopy around the mouse nibblings. And eventually it was published by them, Viking Penguin. And then later it came out in America, and Americans always like to change the cover and change the title in case anyone bought the British edition. So then they'll buy two editions. Later on, I also did the book of the translation of the Bardo Todal, published by Raleigh Book. In general, then I wanted to come to this slide next. So here, this is a Mongolian illuminated text, Padmasambhava on the left and Atisha on the right. In general, Padmasambhava is regarded by Central Asians as the founder of the old schools of Tibetan Buddhism, so-called Nyingma. And he's really just a figurehead of that in a way, because Buddhism was in Tibet long before him and many other masters, but he's sort of collectively, he's used as a kind of a symbol of all of that movement. Often it's said that Tibetan Book of the Dead was written by him as a treasure text and concealed and discovered 6 or 7 centuries later by Karma Lingpa. Whether or not one thinks texts are actually written and concealed and found in that way, or as one Nyingma Lama friend of mine put it, he buried that text on the mind of a student, one of his 25 great disciples, who was later reborn as a human and remembered the text. So some people take that interpretation. Some say Padmasambhava wrote Tibetan Book of the Dead, others that Karma Lingpa had it on his mind stream from his days with Padmasambhava in a previous lifetime. Sort of like me, nothing I'm saying tonight is anything I know. I'm just in a previous lifetime. I happen to have that stream of consciousness. I'm really now fast asleep, just speaking the words from a previous lifetime. What Karma Lingpa does with his text, or Padmasambhava does, and that Karma Lingpa later reveals and propagates, is take all of the teachings on death and dying taught by the Buddha in Abhidharma, as well as taught by the Buddha in various tantric systems. In other words, it goes through what would be several hundred very profound scriptures, extracts their essence, and recasts them in a completely brilliant manner. So brilliant that it's often regarded as one of the greatest classics to come out of Central Asia in the 2,000 years of literary history that we know of Central Asia. Now, Atisha is often seen as the forefather of all of the new schools of Tibetan Buddhism that arose in the 11th century. So often in Tibetan world and Central Asian world, they have those two kind of, that twofold division. The old schools, which uses one kind of language and translated works from Sanskrit using one particular kind of terminology. And then from Atisha, which kind of retranslated a lot and revised a lot of the translations and sort of put a slightly different focus on things. An interesting thing in Mongolia is that these two are always put together, Padmasambhava and Atisha. And I think that's because in Tibet itself, at first, Nyingma stayed quite strong, Nyingma and the new schools all strongly influenced by Atisha. But later, in the time of the great Shabkar, one of the greatest mystical poets, he spontaneously composed something like 2,000 or 3,000 poems and songs. People walk up to him and say, Shabkar means white feet. They walk up to him and say, WF, would you sing me a mystical song? So he would sort of lean back and let his mind go open for a moment and then sing 50 or 60 verses or 100 verses of exquisite spiritual poetry, equal to, I think, in quality, you would have to say the great poems of Rumi, Kabir, and the other great mystics of Central Asia. And when Atisha came to Tibet, there was an 82-year-old master who's considered the greatest living master in Tibet, and he invited Atisha into his main temple, and they walked in front of each of the frescoes in the temple, and in front of each one, Atisha chanted very long, beautiful poems. And after they came through, the great scholar said to him, I've never heard any of those before. Where do they come from? He said, I just made them up. So in that same way, Atisha himself was one of the great poets and spontaneous mystical writers. So in Mongolia, usually they put those two together and put together the old way of looking at the Bardo Todol and the new way of looking at Bardo Todol. So this is a Mongolian edition of the Bardo Todol with the Bardo written first. The red script is written in Tibetan and the sort of little stringy step is known as the Mongol standing script. So it's basically an edition in with Mongolian translation. Unfortunately, not many pages from it survived. A big problem with the antique dealers in Asia after the communist destruction of Mongolia in the 1920s and 1930s was that it became more profitable to sell a page like that for a couple of $100 than it was to keep the whole text together and sell it for $300. Selling separately, you could get 10 times the price. So a lot of these kind of texts, we no longer have the complete text. Padmasambhava often shown in this sort of rainbow form. The idea which is at the core of Padmasambhava's legacy is that our mind itself has the nature of clear light. And out of the clear light, riding upon the clear light, are our karmic energies. You could say the instincts from this and previous lives, our genetic drivers inherited from our male and female ancestors, and also the karmic instincts from previous lives. These energies support our clear light consciousness and then emanate out from it in rainbow form, so often shown in this way, rainbow emanation. Sometimes it's put in front of lotuses. He's put surrounded by lotuses because just like a lotus grows in mud but is not stained by mud, in the same way we can do all karmic actions and remain unstained by any karmic distortion if we just keep full awareness of wisdom or radiance, the infinity of things, combined with the great love and compassion for all living beings. Love and compassion by itself won't do the trick, because love and compassion without wisdom will always be biased. It'll always have preferences. Whereas the wisdom is that force which sees the essential integrity of all things, and seeing that essential integrity sees how nothing stands apart, nothing has separate nature. In other words, that big classic term, nime, non-duality, the wisdom of the emptiness of the duality of all things. You may look at me and think, Glenn Mullin, he's so handsome, so wise, so compassionate. He must be different than me, separate from me. But no. There is no duality. And the wisdom in Buddhism is basically has that meaning. It doesn't mean giving useful advice or socially beneficial advice or anything like that. It has the meaning of understanding the unity or integrity of all things, or put another way, the non-duality, emptiness of separate nature of all things, emptiness of separate essence. How all things are basically part of the one river of flow. And the human mind, of course, doesn't experience like that, does it? It thinks my bank account and your bank account, my car, my wife, your wife. But we can see sometimes people get confused. Who's my wife? Who's your wife? What's my bank account? It proves the unity of all things, doesn't it? So the lotus kind of represents that. When we see the unity of all things, everything we do, as on my email server, I use a verse from the second Dalai Lama, which puts that in tantric language. And it puts, outside, the whole world is seen as blissful mandala. Inside, all living beings seen as dancing angels and angelettes. And secretly, the mind rests in bliss and wisdom. When one has that going for oneself, all activities are spiritual, equally spiritual, regardless of how they conventionally appear. So the lotus is often used for that. It looks so solid, and it looks so beautiful, but it grows out of mud, and if you take it in your hand, it just crumbles and goes down to dust and goes back and becomes mud. Also, Padmasambhava said, born from a lotus. Some people think that, like Moses, he was abandoned and put in a bunch of bulrushes in a basket and then was discovered by a king and raised as the king's son, and in fact became a prince in his youth. Later he became a monk, and then he gave up being a monk to become a forest dweller, a Mahasiddha, and so on. Went on to achieve enlightenment near Kathmandu in Nepal. I think 7 or 8 years ago I took a group of about 45 theosophical folks from around the world to those sacred places. I think 3 of them achieved enlightenment in Parpeng. One fell down and broke his leg. So often Padmasambhava is more associated with the Tantra side and Atisha more with the Sutra side, but I put in this slide because here he's shown surrounded by the 84 Indian Mahasiddhas. In fact, many Tibetans say Padmasambhava was reborn as Atisha, that there are in fact 2 sides of the same coin. Just to put things in a little bit of perspective, the Buddhist wheel of life and death, at the center of the 6 realms, the hells, the ghosts, the animals, the humans, the asuras, and the devas. And on the outside, the 12 links of dependent origination by which we go up and down on the wheel of life and death, by which we go in and out of happiness, in and out of self-imprisonment and so on. And at this is a newer one at the Sakya Monastery in Lumbini. I wanted to include it simply because the center is so much more being in modern pigments, the other one being several hundred years old. The center bit isn't quite as clear. What takes us down the three poisons of attachment, anger or irritation, and ignorance of the non-dual nature of the self, ignorance of our selflessness, our non-selfness, our non-selfness. On the right side, as you look at the piece, the forces that pull one down when one is driven by ignorance, by attachment, and by aversion and anger, one enters into activities that make one's life more and more bound. And on the left, being pulled from darkness up toward the light and toward enlightenment, when instead of anger, one cultivates patience, forgiveness, love, compassion. Instead of attachment, cultivates joy, celebration, a sense of sharingness, and so on. And instead of ignorance, cultivates a sense of the interconnectedness of all things. One goes up toward enlightenment. Now, many Buddhists don't take those six realms, hells, ghosts, and whatnot to be external states, but rather human emotional states, the hells being anger and violence. Whenever you're angry or feeling violent, you're in a kind of a hell state. And ghosts, greedy ghosts, are kind of whenever you're attached, feeling needy, insufficient. I need this to be happy. I need that to be happy. That's your ghost-like psychology. Whenever you're doing things without mindfulness, you're drifting off on this or that and just acting on instinct. That's animal mind. Ordinary human means you're kind of just being a little bit narcissistic and arrogant. And then the asuras, jealousy and envy. And the devas, the worldly gods, pride, personal power, affluence, and using those for self-indulgence rather than for liberation and enlightenment. And always at the top of those kind of paintings, they have an enlightened being pointing over to something. In this case, he's pointing over to the wheel of Dharma. In other words, how we become free from those forces. And how we become free of is, of course, the opposites to the ignorance, the anger, and often described as the Eightfold Path, the 37 wings of enlightenment, the 16 this is, and the 50 that's, and the 84,000s. Anyway, in the end, it's just a wheel that rolls merrily, merrily along the street. Now, to come back to the Bardo Tudol is based on this idea of the Tibetan Wheel of Life and how we at any time can achieve enlightenment. And the key to that is in this figure, Samantabhadra, male-female in union. The idea is that when our male energies are too strong, our aggression and our anger becomes too strong. When our female energies are too strong, our attachments become too strong. And when male and female are in balance, but they're not sufficiently intensified, then we suffer from a kind of a mental apathy or mistiness. And so in either of those cases, we're basically spinning on the wheel of life and death. When we bring male and female energies into perfect harmony, then we're basically able to step back from the wheel of life, sort of like driving a car with a stick shift when you put in the clutch, so to speak. And if we can carry that to complete realization, then we become a Buddha, a fully enlightened master, a fully enlightened being. So surrounding that, male, the Samantabhadra, male and female in union, are the Buddhas of the six realms. In other words, when that happens, the violence of our hells is pacified, and the attachments and longing and craving of our ghostly nature are pacified. The arrogance of our, the mindlessness or unconscious activity of our animal nature is pacified. The arrogance of our simply humanity, self-centered humanity is pacified. Jealousy and envy of our asura or lower god nature is pacified. The pride, arrogance, and self-indulgence of the devas is all pacified simply by bringing male-female into balance. And so much of what is taught in the Tibetan Book of the Dead is put in that context. And here it goes from the simple male-female in balance to the five Buddhas in balance. And in the Buddhist world, we talk of the five skandhas, our form, which means everything we see, smell, taste, touch, hear, and think about what we see, smell, taste, touch, and hear. So each one of those is connected to one of the five senses. Now, when the male and female are in perfect balance, when we're seeing, when we're smelling, when we're hearing, when we're tasting, and we're touching, we experience that phenomena with complete freedom, without any grasping, without any holding, without any distance. The experience of what we hear, to put it in a kind of a ordinary Western, normal, modern way, is or contemporary language, is completely in the here and now. We see with total intensity and total clarity, smell with total intensity, total clarity. No pushing, no pulling, no distortion by the false sense of self and duality. Therefore, in the Tibetan Book of the Dead, it said on the first, after you done, at the time of death, first you experience the clear light of death, and then in the 7 days to follow, first you experience Samantabhadra, then you experience the five Buddhas, and then you experience, in other words, you're kind of unwinding these ways of identifying with mind and objects of mind. But the what you feel or think you are with what you feel or think you're experiencing. And sometimes these five Buddhas are put in form of a hat. And if you ever attended tantric rituals, it's very common they will wear a hat like this. When high lamas die, often they cremate them, and when they cremate them, they put them in a full tantric outfit, wearing a hat like this to represent the transformation of the five skandhas into the five Buddhas. So in the Nyingma tradition, after as we start to die, we go into clear light, we go into the Bardo, then they speak about experiencing the peaceful and wrathful deities, the 42 peaceful and the 58 wrathful deities. But what it's really just talking about is these five Buddha forms. In other words, experiencing five dimensions of our soul, the five radiances of our soul, and working through our positive and negative energies, so to speak. So with the peaceful ones, often these are associated with our female side. And in Buddhism we say every person, every human being is unigender or bigenderfied, that essentially we contain all the instincts, outer inner secret of both sexes. From male and female ancestors, we have the male and female drives, male and female in previous lives, male and female drives. And in terms of our, you could say, our essential ensouledness, then we have our basic wish to absorb some and wish to conquer things, the wish to incorporate things and wish to dominate things, our instinct, I should say, being our male and female drives. So the next part of the Bardo Tudal is talking about that, firstly in a kind of a beautiful way with the female side, and secondly with an aggressive, forceful way with the wrathful deities, which is stressing the male side. And if we come back to the new tantras, they also speak in this same way, but rather than use that specific language, they talk about the three dimensions of the soul, three dimensions of the spirit. The utter radiance dimension, which we experience at the moment of death. Coming out of the radiance of the moment of death, there is the emotive and conceptual side of things, the instinct for experiencing things emotionally and conceptually, which becomes the Bardo, the first levels of the Bardo, the visionary Bardo. And thirdly, the instinct to express, for the soul to express and act in the ordinary world. So these deities, basically these tantric deities, the main practice when you do the mandala is known in Tibetan as kusum lam kir, taking the three kayas as the path. In other words, the clear light of the moment of death, taking that as the path of your moment-by-moment life. Every moment in life, we have a radiant quality of consciousness. It's obvious at the moment of sleep, obvious at the moment of death. Most obvious at the moment of sleep, most obvious at the moment of death. Secondly, the emotive and conceptual, when we're sleeping at night, dreams, and in the Bardo, the visions. And thirdly, we wake up from sleep. That's like re-manifesting. This is the soul re-manifesting in a new world, a world in which the whole geometry and physics and structure has transformed. This is my own favorite image in Tantra because I was born in the year of the bull. But the two horns of the bull, one represents the clear light consciousness, which is our essential soul nature, and the other represents the energy that drives the soul. And when those two are in perfect balance, enlightenment is immediately attained. And in this one, they're shown in union, because when clear light mind and the energy supporting clear light mind arise with total joy or total bliss, enlightenment is immediately or instantly attained. And here, with the erect lingam or organ, when the mind is driven by great bliss. Again, the symbol is the same. Enlightenment or freedom, liberation, release is easily attained. So these are just different forms of that mandala of the 42 and 58 from the Tibetan Book of the Dead, but all the tantras have a similar process without using 42 and 58. Now, Karma Lingpa in the book says the best is during your lifetime achieve enlightenment by means of the tantric yogas. So these represent what he means by the tantric yogas, the kind of kundalini, or in Buddhism we say chandali rather than kundalini, process, and by means of bringing male-female energies of the body into perfect harmony, the mind is made to arise with a very special frequency, and one day of meditation becomes like 100 years of ordinary meditation. It's often said like that. So he says, best is achieve enlightenment by means of the tantric yogas in this lifetime. And if you can't do that, then at the time of death, you should try and say to yourself, should I apply the tantric yogas in the Bardo? Should I apply these Tibetan Book of the Dead methods in the Bardo? Or should I just say, I'm not very good at them? And therefore, just make an auspicious prayer for enlightenment. And that's a kind of, I guess you would say, when the rubber hits the metal, kind of a moment and kind of a decision. So in the Nyingma world, it's often said when we achieve enlightenment, it's like this mandala, like this paradise, like this pure land. So here Amitabha represents Dharmakaya, the clarity of the mind, the basic clear-like consciousness. Avalokiteshvara represents compassion and wisdom, the emotivity and conceptuality of enlightenment. And Padmasambhava represents Nirmanakaya, enlightenment, wisdom, and compassion as manifest in activity in the world. Myself, that his paradise or pure land is called the copper-colored mountain. When I died in my last life, I was looking for that place. And unfortunately, there's a place in Canada with the same name in the middle of the forest. So rather than be reborn on that paradise, I was reborn in a little French village in Canada of the same name. So it's important if you're going to do that kind of practice to have the GPS settings. often in the new schools, rather than the copper-colored mountain paradise of Padmasambhava, instead they, at the time of death for if they're just going to do a kind of a wishing for a happy rebirth and a dedication, they'll do the Amitabha practice. Otherwise, they do a practice called Poa, and the two yoginis represent that. If one can control the energies at the time of death, one tries to die consciously. Dying consciously, you put the little red or the little white yogini on the top of your head, and as you breathe out your last breath and as you feel the energies move your body and the energies dissolve into the heart chakra, and then basically those energies, coarse energies, totally subside. And as the soul gets ready to leave the body, one directs it into the birth passage of the Dakini. And then the Dakini, one leaves the body in that way through the crown chakra. And I think the essential meaning is that all humans are born from a womb, and we have a very deep yearning to return to the womb. So it's sort of using that very profound instinctual yearning at the time of death. And both the Dakinis are visualized as sort of quite beautiful 16-year-olds. So it sort of combines this deep returning to the womb with a kind of an admiration for the beauty of the mother. Because, you know, mothers, once they're like 80 or 90, they still have inner beauty, but they're not totally as beauty in the same way. This is a Mongolian painting in my own collection from the Poa or death practice from the white yogini as done in Mongolia. And then I thought I'd conclude just with a few kind of interesting little death tidbits before we have questions and answers. Buddha's own passing, and 3 months before he passed, Buddha sent out a message telling everyone where he was going to die and when he was going to die, and told people to meet him there, and they did in Kushinagar. And then he died laying down on his right side. My own guru, Kebje Ling Dorje Chang, died in the same way. He stretched out on his right side and put his finger above his nose like this and passed away in that same position. And then he lay there for, I think it was 18 days, without any degeneration. He lay there in meditation, even with the body undegenerating. So soul still kept at the heart chakra, just to show his tantric competence. And behind is the funeral pyre. This one also kind of shows how the passing is not a sad thing, but it's kind of a beautiful celebration in another way. Of course, one always feels sad over the loss, but there's also the beauty of the transformation and the moving on, the transition, and so on. Often it's said the first kindness of the Buddha was teaching, and then his last kindness was passing away, because it's important for all students to know that the teacher is just a teacher, and you should come to equal the teacher. If our teachers hung around all the time, we'd never realize our own power. Something like that is the kind of meaning of that kind of expression. Earlier, this was one of my own gurus who died, and very often in the Tibetan world, he died sitting up in meditation. So they put one of those hats on him for his cremation ceremony, as well as a full tantric outfit. So there he's being carried to the funeral pyre, and that's where he was cremated. And these are relics which came from him. What they like, with usually in the Tibetan Central Asian world, they cremate the great masters, and they produce these kind of relics, which are blessing things, and they reproduce. They're crystalline, so you put them in glasses, and they basically multiply. And you see little ones fall off the big ones, and then slowly become bigger, and then bigger. Others fall off of them, and slowly become bigger. And one of my gurus, when he passed away, there was just like maybe 20 or 30 of these, and now there's like 1,000 or something. But all different colors, like little gems and rubies and crystalline structures. And then they put these in stupas and in statues and other things to bring blessings. And it said if you're really sensitive in front of them, you can actually communicate. They're kind of like portals directly to enlightenment itself. This is what they look like more up close. And Lama Zopa from Nepal sends around a tour of those relics. And I think Chris was telling me you've brought them here to the Theosophical Society on a couple of occasions. They've put together relic tours where they basically go around the world and just bless places, usually staying for a week or two. Now, for people who aren't saints and you don't want their relics, there's a body to dispose of. Usually they do an astrological chart and decide to the air, to the earth, to fire, or to water, to one of the four elements. But Tibetans generally prefer offering to the air, which means feeding to the birds. And so most Tibetan towns and Central Asian towns have a jator, a gift to the birds site. So this is one such. When I was in Tibet with the second Theosophical group I took, which Tim was with that, traveling with that one, your president, and we stayed at Drikung, which is one of the famous bird offering sites. But this one here, I think, is actually at Drakyurpa, Atisha's meditation cave and Padmasambhava's meditation cave. And amazingly, there were like hundreds of birds come every day, because usually, you know, there'll be one or two people a day. So they come as like your pussycat coming for morning chow. And it's very considered very auspicious, because when you put in water, you know, sea burial, even though there's some good things about it. Another thing is you kind of pollute the water a little bit, especially if, you know, if you're in a cold climate like Tibet in the winter, the ice. And burying, you take up good agricultural ground. Fire, you burn a lot of wood. And if you're not going to get relics out of it, why bother, right? So offering to birds is considered very auspicious because birds fly up into the sky, which is on an inauspicious direction. If anyone wants to feel good, you just lie flat on the ground any time of the sunny day and look at the sky, you'll immediately feel good. Just looking at a bird flying in the sky makes people feel good. So then when the birds will just sit there waiting until the chipas, the cutters, prepare the bodies. The way they prepare them, they make long strips this way and then strips this way so they can pull off little kind of McNuggets so they don't kind of damage themselves doing it. Then when all the flesh is gone, they throw them into a kind of mortar pestle. Let's pulverize it a bit and mix it with some wet barley flour. I think, you know, the Theosophical Society here could set up something like that, and it's kind of a big property. I think it's much better than all that burying business. I mean, a lot of cities now, they're like digging up people and burying them deeper and burying people on top of them. And cremation is like air pollution. And this is like an act of goodness. But amazingly with those birds, they're so well behaved. They're almost like tame. And the cutters will go out and prepare the bodies. I think the last time I was at one of those, they had 7 people at it, or other 7 or 9. So really a lot of them, they're preparing. And the birds wait totally patiently. When all 7 bodies are prepared, the maestro, the conductor of the orchestra, I guess you'd say the grand chef, waves, and the birds just all fly in, 200 or 300 of them. And within a half hour, all 7 or 9 bodies are completely gone. And then 20 minutes pulverizing, a little bit of barley thrown in, and another 20 minutes, that's all gone. And then at the end, the big birds fly away. And this one here, I suspect this is after the meal, because sometimes, if some days like Lhasa, there'll be 15 people. So that's like eating like 10 Big Macs or something like that all at once. So these guys get quite heavy and can hardly take off for an hour or so they've digested the meal. And so usually they hang out on the top. And usually just to like bug them, I'll like go up and walk and take a run through them and make them fly, work off some of their calories. But it's not so easy to run at that direction. Drikung, this is at about 16,500 feet or 16,800 feet, something like that. So it's way up there. Then I just conclude with a couple of Alex Grays, my very dear friend, a New York Buddhist artist who sort of tries to show, very inspired by the Tibetan Book of the Dead, tries to show this sort of multidimensionality of the world in which we live. Wrap up very briefly, in the Bardo Todol, we can achieve, as it's taught again and again, the best achieve enlightenment in this lifetime. If you can't, achieve it in your sleep, in the dream state, by practicing dream yoga. If you can't do that, then achieve it at the moment of death. If you can't do that, achieve it in the Bardo. If you can't do that, at least live an excellent life. Learn to watch your inner mindfulness, have control over your mind. Try to die in a state of total mindfulness. Live in goodness, die in mindfulness. As one of my gurus wrote in one of his books, the title of one of his books, Happy Life, Happy Death. When that happens, happy rebirth. It said anyone who practiced Tantra, the smartest achieves enlightenment in one lifetime, medium in 6 or 7 lifetimes, and even stupidos within 16 lifetimes. So may you be the best of the best, or at least the medium of the medium. Or if you're a stupido, at least get the 16. 16 down. So thank you very much for listening. And now we've got about a half hour, I think, if anyone wants to ask anything or bring up any points of discussion.
Yeah, when was the actual Tibetan Book of the Dead written?
Well, because it's a terma, means treasure revelation, the declaration is that the composition is attributed to Padmasambhava, which means 750 to 775 or 780, something like that. But it's usually not said like that. It's usually said it was hidden and discovered by Karmalingpa, who was 14th century, early 15th century. So about 700 years later. So it's one of those two periods. And people who are literalists think Padmasambhava really wrote it, as I put it earlier. And people who are not literalists think that he inspired it. Many terma treasure revelations are revealed in dreams, in meditation, and in what Tibetans call daknang, which means visionary experiences. For instance, in my Living in the Face of Death book, I include a chapter from a great Nyingma Lama of the 1950s. I think he died in 1954, who was a dream revealer. And so if anyone wanted to know anything, they'd ask him to come to their house and dream, and he would dream the answer. And so then he was invited when he was passing through Spiti, which is just up behind Simla in India. Madame Blavatsky, one of her trips into Tibet, went in that way, it's said. And there was a sacred mountain, Giri Mountain, and no one knew why it was sacred. They couldn't remember the story about it. And there was a cave on the mountain, and there was a stupa on the mountain, and a couple of big holes in the mountain, and no one could remember why it was sacred. But everyone still went there in pilgrimage and made offerings, but they weren't quite clear on why. And so they asked him to come and sleep there. And he did, and he had a dream. And in the dream, he dreamed of Geri Lama, who was a student of Gutsang, one of the great Drikung or Drukpa Kagyu Lamas, one of his students. And he used to go to Nepal in the summer and come back in the autumn and do an overwinter retreat there for 9 months of the year. And everyone in the valley became students of his over that 20 or 30 year period, except for one proud princess who thought he didn't like him. And so he thought, well, I guess I'll try to have an impact on her life. I haven't been able to have an impact on her life. So there was one barley field that she especially liked, because the barley that came out of it was very rich and very tasty. So he took his horse and ran up and down it and trampled all the barley into the earth. And the princess came running out saying, oh, don't do that, da-da-da-da-da. And he said, you know, what can you do? If I want to ride my horse up and down your head, I'll do it. And he rode off to Nepal. And then next spring, he's riding back, and someone meets him and says, oh, Princess Wangmo has plotted your assassination. So be very careful, maybe you shouldn't go this year. And he says, yeah, I know, they plotted my assassination. That's part of the whole plot. That's why I drove my horse up and down her barley field and said I could drive it up and down your head if I wanted. And then he came back and his horse fell into the pit that she had dug on the road. And then she had put a rock with a trap, big boulder, so an avalanche would then fall in on him and kill him. But he held up his hand to hold the rock up so as not to let the horse get hurt, because it wasn't part of the horse's drama. It was his drama with the princess. So he helped the horse out, and then he lay down and the avalanche fell in on him and he died. And then the wind started making funny sounds, and the princess started feeling guilty. Whoops, maybe it's not just a scoundrel I've killed. Maybe it really was a great being. I better. And she couldn't sleep, so she ran out to the pit. And then many villagers saw this, and the wise man of the village says, oh, princess, you're looking very upset. What has happened? What's going on here? And she said, well, this guy insulted me, so I assassinated him. And now I feel terrible. It turns out he was a good guy, not like just an insulter. And the wise old man of the village says, well, don't feel too bad about it. Princesses are princesses, it's obviously, someone speaks to you like that and does something like that, they should know that there's going to be some sort of result. So don't feel bad about it, but still, you should build a stupa for him and see that he gets a good cremation, and build a little temple, stuff like that, and do a few Vajrasattva mantras. And so then she took one of the rocks which had fallen on him, and which was the rock that they thought killed him, and dug a hole in it and wore it as a little jewel around her neck, and dedicated the remainder of her life to practice and studied under his main students and achieved enlightenment in one lifetime and became a living female Buddha. So this is like the account of that mountain. Now, for Tibetans, that's a totally true story. Now, if he dreamed that Padmasambhava said that to him, it would be a revelation from Padmasambhava. It would be attributed to Padmasambhava. And so that would be said, Padmasambhava taught this, as though he had taught it in the 8th century. So time, in Tantric Buddhism, there's this talk about the fourth time, past, present, future, and the fourth time is how all time is all simultaneous. All three times are simultaneously present, which is the fourth time zone. So when your mind is in the fourth time zone, you can skip to any period in history without any physical movement or any time machine. You just basically take the wormhole that goes through the fabric of time to a particular time and place. So you can, just zip in on Padmasambhava and say, "Hey, Padma, give me a lineage." And he say, "Okay, listen." And then he'll, if it's like Evan Swentz's translation of the Tibetan Book of the Dead, he'll start talking to you in King James English. Or if it's, I like both Punch and New Yorker magazines for my English, so all of my books are written. If I translate from Tibetan into English, I try to make them look like those writers are well read on both Punch and the New Yorker.
I've always admired Alex Gray's work, and I wondered if you know how it was that he began doing artwork of that kind, what inspired him to do that kind of artwork.
I don't think there's any logic or reason to these lunatic artists. he and his wife in their youth were street performing artists. They would do things like build a glass case in Central Park and get in there naked for like 2 weeks and stuff like that. And he's always been a very talented painter. I think he grew up on sort of the tail end of the Andy Warhol period, when artists were exploring all new mediums, in his case, he had strong connections with various Buddhist masters in his youth, firstly with Zen, and then with Trungpa, and later with Gelug Rinpoche. So when I met him, it was with Gelug Rinpoche in New York. But I think this idea in Tantra and in some of the tantric more formalist traditions like Mahamudra and Dzogchen, how all phenomena appear within the mind, not separate from mind, all things projections of your own mind. Heaven and hell are both the same place, just looked at with different eyes. Paradise is always in the present moment. Those kind of ideas were very, very strong. And he's a very, very well practiced and visionary person. I mean, as I was mentioning to someone earlier, to Paula actually, we were discussing arts and music and so on. In the Buddhist world, we say after someone achieves enlightenment, they manifest as nirmanakaya in one of three forms. And one is known as supreme nirmanakaya, which manifests as kind of great teachers. And then ordinary nirmanakaya manifests in various ways in the world. And the third is as great musicians and artists. And often they don't know their manifestations. They think they're real people. They don't know they're mere clones. And so many enlightened beings going around have been cloned or emanated to go around as enlightened beings, but not knowing that they're enlightened. You just might be one of them. And I think, I don't know if any of you go to New York, he's got a wonderful house, what does he call his place there? Do you remember something like
a house of crystal mirrors or something like this, a sort of a meditation center with housing art and sort of the art of the art of enlightenment and the enlightenment in art and those kind of themes, well worth a visit. And if you look them up on the web, you'll find where it is.
I want to ask about POA practice.
POA?
Is it a good idea to practice that for a dying person other than yourself, for a friend or relative?
I think that, you know, the general sentiment is that the closer relationship you have with someone who has died or is dying, the more you can benefit them. And so if you have a close relationship with that person, any prayers or auspicious thoughts, good energies you put into their process, the better it is. So for instance, at these places of the bird offerings, there's always a couple of yogis or monks or practitioners who are considered to be very good at POA. And the night before the bird offering, they do POA practice for all however many bodies they have. If there's just one, just for that one. If they've got 10 or 15, do it for all 10 or 15. And that it won't hurt in any way, and it could help. In addition, any sort of auspicious words or deeds are considered very useful. In the Buddhist world, they think after you die, usually the consciousness of the soul of the person hangs around the body for some days. So often Tibetans don't like to have a body touched for 3 or 4 days afterwards. Obviously in the West, that's not possible. When I was at the death of a father of a friend once, I suggested trying to leave it at least 24 hours, but in that state, it wasn't legal. You have to take it out. Some states where they, you know, have the land of the free and the home of the brave, where it's legal. I don't know, probably Arizona or Nevada, Utah, I don't know. But it's those kind of things are state jurisdictions, so that makes it a problem from the traditional way of looking at things. Other things one can do for them is, you know, offer butter lamps or candles. You know, if they were Catholic, offer it at a Catholic temple for them, or if they were Mormon, I don't know what Mormons do, but, you know, do something for them that's in their kind of language world or spiritual world that's connected to them emotionally. And in the Buddhist world, it's thought that they probably feel it. Then 49 days later, all Asians always do something big, and then once a year for that, on the death anniversary, they always do special offerings. Because even if they've taken rebirth and they're in another realm, you still have a close karmic connection with them.
In terms of the Bardo Thought School, going in there, you admonished not to go toward the smoky light. You're supposed to go toward the bright light. So if you had to go to, for example, the blue light, and you have the smoky light down below, how would you apply that to daily living?
Mm-hmm. Again, with each of these phases, the 49 days in Bardo is 7 times 7. So these 7 are thought to be 7 levels of consciousness. So we're always fluctuating between those 7 levels of consciousness. The 5 which are sensual, 4 connected to the 4 elements, and the 3 dimensions of mind are the 3 aspects of consciousness, subtle consciousness. And I think in terms of daily life, the idea is that with all objects of the 5 senses, plus with emotions and with concepts, to always have the sense of your own mind as this vast, radiant sky, often said with three characteristics: very joyful, very shining, and very relaxed. And whatever arises within it is a radiance, is a it's an appearance, but it's almost like a theater in your mind. So with the sense of self and other, the exchange between those phenomena, between the sense of self and sense of subject-object, to retain that clarity. So here the different senses are given a different Buddha, they're given a different color, and so on. But the idea, I think, is just to keep the radiance very clear, very pure, and not to let it become dull. In the Buddhist, you know, in meditation, samadhi, often if they talk of the six bardos, which is discussed to some extent in the Bardo Todol, bardo of birth to death in ordinary times, bardo of sleep and dreams, and ordinary, bardo of samadhi, then the three levels of experience leading up to death, the moment of death, and the transition phase. All six of those bardos have that same infrastructure of a fluctuation between seven dimensions of consciousness. And so I think the real meaning is always be relaxed, clear. If you're seeing green, keep it clear green. If you're seeing blue, keep it clear blue. And here, these are being references to the sensual phenomena or the experience of the world as other than something than yourself. What is an object of the sense? It's an object, it's a sense that there's a dog out there. To have that relationship between you and the dog, one of vibrant radiance. Or as one of my teachers, Lama Yeshe, once put it, when you go in the supermarket, have great joy and celebration, and don't come down in the chocolate aisle by eating too much chocolate. Yes, over here.
How does a great teacher like a Padmasambhava come to be? I mean, you know, there are all these legends about him, but beyond that, he's obviously transcending time, transcending everything, changing everything on earth when he's around. I mean, where does he come from? I mean, I know that the lore or the way it's all set up in the hierarchy is he's coming from, I don't know, Tushita or some other place. But I mean, how does that kind of Buddha being, whatever, even get that kind of influence that's beyond what we can really even comprehend, you know, so that he's going in people's dreams, he's just operating on all these different levels.
Well, I think there's a number of factors at play. Firstly, I think anyone who has the karma or destiny to be a spiritual teacher has some kind of connection with a large number of people. And even very ordinary teachers will have students who send them emails, say, I had this dream, you appeared in it and said this and blah, blah, blah. It's a very common phenomenon if you have a close spiritual relationship with people, that the appearing in dreams and other ways manifest. I think in terms of who succeeds as a world phenomena, it's a little more connected to specifics of karmic alignment. So for instance, in the Bardo Todol, it said if you don't achieve enlightenment in the Bardo by the seventh the seventh cycle, you're going to have to take rebirth. So you start looking for the perfect set of parents for you to fulfill your next role. And then you apply the yoga of trying to take rebirth as a Vajra master, a Rigden, a knowledge holder. It means looking for a time and a place and an exact astrological makeup of the universe where you will be maximally beneficial in that lifetime. And I think, in the Buddhism, we think there's two ways you die. One is you die in a state of heavy attachments, angers, fears, jealousies, envies, and ignorance. Ignorance here meaning clinging to a sense of self which is not the real self. And those people go into the Bardo and they get thrown helter-skelter as they would in any dream, dragged from pillar to post by the objects of the dream, because they're like a fish. If you throw a fish hook out and a whale bites it, you're going to get dragged all over the water. So someone who has a strong addiction to a personal sense of self or a personal identity will get stuck on that, and it will pull them this way and that way and this way and that way. Their angers and attachments will come up with things to do with threatening that sense of self, and they'll get basically dragged into negative states. In Buddhism we say if you die angry, then it's hell. If you die greedy, it's a ghost. If you die mindless, then it's an animal. If you die arrogant, it's a human in a kind of an unpleasant way. If you die jealous, envy, asura, and so on. This may just be sort of metaphorical, but anyway, some negative energies come in when there's no control. If instead you have wisdom, compassion, love, openness, sense of self, and then it's time to take rebirth, and then you'll look around, okay, right now there's 2 million people making love. And then you zip into their bedrooms and watch them for a while. Now, you shouldn't do it too long or it can be considered voyeurism. But, Tibetan Book of the Dead, as well as Buddha and the idea Abhidharma, says everyone chooses their parents. Your parents don't choose you. They choose to open a space for an invited guest. But the actual guest who comes chooses that space. So you wander around looking for something that's both appropriate and deserving for you, something that you're karmically up to. Every birth has some positive quality, even if it's many great obstacles. You can learn through your obstacles and become a great enlightened being, as many beings in the past have done. Otherwise, some people, like Padmasambhava, will be born with this difficult conditions. He's born, as an unwanted kid, and he's put in a basket and put down by the lake, and he's an abandoned throwaway kid, if you look at it in a kind of a normal way. Otherwise, they say born from a lotus. If you think people can be born from a lotus, then okay. But he started with that difficult situation, but then the king walks by and picks him up, and his chief wife can't have children, and the wife is walking with him and says, chief queen, and she says, oh, I like the kid, can I adopt him? And they do, and they see he's bright and so on and so forth, so they raise him as a prince. He has a great education, a little bit of bad luck. He gets in an argument with one of his relatives and throws a spear at him, and it happens to kill him. So even though he's a prince, he gets banished, but that's good, because then he goes and has to do other things and princely things. It helps with his learning experience. He goes to the charnel grounds and meditates with dead bodies for a long time to sort of study what is this thing, death, that happened. Then he becomes a monk and becomes a great scholar. Then later becomes a great meditator and then becomes a great master. But I think one of the key messages in the Bardo Tudal is if in our time of meditating we can be very mindful and always keep wisdom, compassion, and patience as our guides, we'll always come out of the tunnel in a positive way. whether it's moment to moment or day to day or lifetime to lifetime. And then, you know, how much of his life is fact and how much is fiction is also unknown, because none of the biographies of him are known to have been written during his lifetime. They're treasure texts written by Yeshe Sogyal or attributed to Yeshe Sogyal, but written out many centuries later. But I think that doesn't lessen who or what, make any less who or what he is in terms of, you know, people's ideas. For instance, Christ, we really don't know much about him. I mean, you could write his words in about three or four pages, right? The Sermon on the Mount and a few interesting sayings here and there. But the kind of mythology builds and builds and builds, or the spiritual enthusiasm builds and builds, whatever you want to put it, and that becomes something way beyond three or four pages of written text. Or if you take Dalai Lama, you know, when he goes around, he gets crowds of Asians for 200,000-300,000 when he gives a kala chakra, and other lamas, just as well trained and whatnot, won't get the same turnouts. It's kind of a little bit to do with one's karma and the time things are going. And some teachers, you know, teach to many, many people and don't have that big a long-term effect. Others teach to just a few people and have a big long-term effect. We don't know how many people Padmasambhava taught to. It doesn't seem to have been that many, you know, a few thousand. But it's become a big deal in the history of Central Asia.